that you play and pretend. 9 out of 10, here we go again. Here's what sticking to the eye kick philosophy is.
We're going to talk hip rotation window. What does that mean? In order for your hip to work effectively and functionally,
you have to be able to rotate internally and externally. So a working model for understanding the joint capsule of the hip is if you take the head, you take your fist and make the head of your femur, put it inside your shirt. If you yank on that thing, right, you're going to see that
it doesn't matter how stiff the rectus femoris is. You're never going to get the kind of approximation stability you do with rotation. One of the reasons that
the hip has an extraordinary rotator cuff, the P-go-go-Q, we kind of think about the shoulder having a rotator cuff, but the P-go-go-Q. Hey, welcome back to the ready state. We are going to talk hip rotation window. What does that mean? In order for your hip to work effectively and functionally, you have to be able to rotate. Hey, welcome back to the ready state.
We are going to talk hip rotation window. What does that mean? In order for your hip to work effectively and functionally, you have to be able to rotate internally and externally.
So a working model for understanding the joint capsule of the hip is if you take the head, take your fist
and make the head of your femur, put it inside your shirt. If you yank on that thing, right, you're going to see that it doesn't matter how stiff the rectus femoris is, you're never going to get the kind of approximation stability you do with rotation. One of the reasons that
the hip has an extraordinary rotator cuff, the P-go-go-Q, we kind of think about the shoulder having a rotator cuff, but the P-go-go-Q is piriformis, two gemelli, the obturators,
and the quadratus femoris. There are a whole bunch of hip short hip rotators
that help steer and guide, and it's not an accident. So it's not just glutes that run the show. So one of the things that we have to appreciate is that if I
can't create or don't have access to this position,
I have fewer movement choices when I move, and I have fewer positions in which to create high levels of stability. And so the body will compensate to create a movement solution. That's the way to think about it. So when we're looking at this and when we assess it on our backs as a therapist, and we look at internal rotation, external rotation, right? We look at the femur rolling back and forth when the femur's straight up and down. This is how we assess this range. We go to 90, right, straight up, leg is straight, and then we go external and we look at internal. Okay, now that's all well and good. But what we see is that when most people are working on rotation, they work on it in non-positions where it's difficult to create a lot of rotation.
And this shape is pretty much in line with my body. So what you're seeing is that we're assessing rotation mostly in this shape, which is not where we're seeing most people miss their rotation. So when we assess rotation in this very mid-range neutral pack position, we end up missing the conversation about what's happening with rotation and flexion. So now keep in mind that if we did more sitting on the ground, yes, we would be rotating through and spending times in different positions, and we'd be noodling back and forth on these shapes
all the time, right? So if you've ever seen any of the old Russian sambo warm-ups or every martial art, this is part of that side-sitting tradition around at least exposing the legs to some of these positions. Now, the key here is that sometimes these passive ranges or just sitting at end range statically do not give us this clean rotation window. And if I'm really being honest, what I should be looking at is I need some weight bearing through that femur, and I should have some internal rotation and some external rotation. We're actually looking, if I was straight up and down with some weight through the femur, I should have a rotation window of 70 to 90 degrees where you talk to. 60 degrees, 30
external, 30 internal at the least, but we would love to have 45 degrees external and at least 30 degrees internal, so 75 to 90 degrees of rotation. Now, it's crucial to think about that if you're missing this rotation, you'll make it up some other way. You'll turn the foot out, you'll bring the leg in, you won't have access, you won't be able to twist, or you'll use your lumbar spine as a different set of rotation parameters. You'll just work up the chain and be like, oh, I'll use my knee, start turning the foot out, we'll solve that problem, we'll start using the lumbar. And we fail to appreciate specifically around the lumbar that a stable hip complex makes a much more dynamic and much more stable pelvis lumbar relationship complex. We try to avoid using the spine as an additional set of hip joints whenever we can, right? This is our basic rules are like, let's let the hip be the hip and let's let the spine do what the spine needs.
But if I'm missing this rotation, I'm missing ability even to extend and flex, then that's going to be more up the chain. We're going to see something we call the tail wagging the dog. So remember, just like when we see the relationship between shoulder and torso, if I can't create an active shoulder when I can, it's much harder for me to have a really stable trunk. And this is key. We can appreciate through the shoulder is being able to create rotation here also creates stability against the trunk. We call this reciprocating stability, right? I have a stable, well-organized platform and I can create high levels of stability, but as soon as I grip the ground and create a little bit of rotation, the upper trunk becomes more stable, and we see less weird compensation positions of people trying to create stable positions from lack of good organized fascia, joint congruency, kind of respecting shapes between the shoulder. Well, the same is true about the hip. So one of the ways that we solve this is we try to take our best mobilizations out of physical therapy and hand them over back to the coach, back to the athlete, back to the person. So one of the ways, again, you can identify if you have enough rotation is to get on your leg and see if you can rotate internally and externally. And what we're seeing is that many of us do not have access to this position. The number one hip problem we see is that people are missing internal rotation. When people are chasing that lack of internal rotation where the leg spins out, that is part of the reason the foot turns out when we squat and knee comes in. It's one of the reasons people reverse early. Again, I've got to have full
access to that rotation window so that the hip can do what it needs to do and create positions of stability. And I can have a full working hip rotator cuff musculature that is can do its job and doesn't get sort of positionally locked and positionally inhibited, for lack of a better phrase. So the joint capsule mode is that I, in this position, and I can wind this up a little further. So I start at 90, and I can push knee to the hip. And this is one of the first mobilizations we ever talked about in the world. This is our joint capsule mode, because this is what it would look like if you were on my table. I'd be driving my weight through your femur to get that hip into a better position. And then we would be talking about external rotation, but really, we'd be obsessing on internal rotation. So as soon as I bring this knee over, that winds that capsule up even further, and I still want some rotation here. So I don't just shift over. I glide sideways, I don't roll, keeping that line of force through the femur. So as I come to the side, I don't drop to the ground. I'm always thinking about pushing through the femur so it comes out the back of the hip, like alien, right? So loading that up, shifting my line of force. Now my line of force is oblique, and in that position, I can start to push into flexion a little bit more. I can add rotation a little bit more, these combination positions. In fact, in this shape, I can even
move my torso and my
pelvis on the femur, or I can use the other leg to be dragging or resisting either direction. I can be resisting internally or resisting externally using the other leg to push and pull. Now, the key here is,
in traditionally, physical therapy, we do 30 seconds of mobilization, and then I would reassess, right?
And it turns out that if you just sing, you know, a couple courses of your favorite song, that'll probably get you to 30 seconds. What we want you to do here is appreciate sometimes that these joint mobilizations take a little time. 2 minutes is a great therapeutic dose on this, but if you're feeling a pinch when you do this, boom, band distraction. And that's why we originally took Brian Mulligan's amazing work on using a band to create a little joint distraction, and we started using that band laterally or posteriorly. So the band, if I was doing this, and I felt a pinch, that pinch is what we call impingement. And it happens. This is the mechanics are bounding up. You might feel a pinch. That's the same pinch that someone with a really sensitized tissue might feel. Eventually, we all run out of tissue range, but when we do, it matters. So what ends up happening is that this is an opportunity for me to say, hey, I can't even flex the hip, or I'm stuck at 90, or I have no rotation.
Let me throw a little band distraction on that laterally, and poof, I might have access to more rotation. That was why, when I first got up off the table,
and had learned hip quadrant as a physical therapist, and then was translating this to myself and my athletes at my gym, we realized that no one had ever used the band to distract laterally, a jump stretch band ourselves. It was always a therapist using a rigid band. So the idea here of using the band was to create a little bit of a change in the relationship of femur to pelvis so that what we could rotate again, right? Now, if you have an athlete who can easily bang over, create tons of rotation, push in, they probably don't need a whole lot of band. So we can use the band for our people who are stiff, who aren't expressing any of this clear rotation in flexion, right? Especially with approximation of the hip. So I stay square, and what's my rotation window? I should have a huge rotation window, femur vertical, and that's really the magic to saying, hey, this is a hip that's working at its normal capacity, its indigenous native capacity. Notice that we're not talking about hip structure or hip architecture. We're not even pushing
beyond 90 degrees. If you think you have a special snowflake hip at 90 degrees, you are very wrong. Or you do have a diagnosis of something like dysplasia, which shows up very, very early, and you know you don't have this because it's bone on bone, or your morphology is very, very specific. The rest of us, 2 standard deviations out, at least, that's the hip architecture stuff is very, very rare. And when we're looking at femur on pelvis, this 90 degrees really is such a mid-range position that we can all agree that our rotation window should be 70 to 90 degrees here. So noodle on this hip rotation window, and notice that if we were working on the ground, sitting on the ground, reaching for things, cooking, doing what we did, playing, we would probably be noodling on all those positions all the time anyway, which is one more reason to be constrain your environment so you have better hip function.
Noodle and obsess about your hip rotation, and you'll see all your numbers. Noodle and obsess about your hip rotation, and you'll see all your numbers. Noodle and obsess about your hip rotation, and you'll see all your numbers. Noodle and obsess about your hip rotation, and you'll see all your numbers.
Columbus, Ohio. Enjoy.
Here's what sticking to the I kick philosophy is. You play and pretend. 9 out of 10. Here we go again.
Here's what sticking to the I kick philosophy is. You play and pretend. 9 out of 10. Here we go again.
Here's what sticking to the I kick philosophy is.
You good, T-minus?